Christians in history. I'm Michael Miller. I'm the associate pastor at First Christian Church in Katy, Texas, just outside of Houston. And I am in my second semester of my fourth year at Phillips Theological Seminary, where I am pursuing my Master of Divinity degree. Tonight's lecture recital is the final project for an independent study course that has been examining the lives and music of some of Christianity's most prolific and well-known composers from the Baroque period. This semester, I have been fortunate to be studying under the guidance of Dr. Lisa Barnett, who has been immensely helpful in helping to put together tonight's presentation. I have a few more remarks at the end of the presentation, but for now, let's begin. Tonight, we will be taking a broad look at the lives of Antonio Vivaldi, Georg Friedrich Händel, and Johann Sebastian Bach. Each of these three composers has had a large impact on Western church music in their own way, and each of these three composers crossed paths at some point with one another, heard of one another, and whose music either influenced or was influenced by one another. Our first and last composers, Vivaldi and Bach, are tied together very obviously by Bach's organ arrangements of Vivaldi Violin Concerti. Händel and Vivaldi crossed paths in Venice in 1709, although it was not entirely clear to me if they had much interaction with one another in the city. And Händel and Bach were both born within one month of another in a course of about 30 or 40 miles. And they had heard of one another throughout their musical careers. The question might come up, why do a study of these three composers when so much has already been written and rewritten about them? And the director of the Houston Bach Society, Rick Erickson, had a perfect response to that. And he notes that throughout history, even though the basic principles of the church has stayed the same, the music has changed, reflecting the church's voice and the church's theology. The music reflects how the voice of the church has changed throughout our history. Even our three composers tonight give us an insight, a small insight, into the voices of three distinct places in church history and the response music played to the various papal decrees, congregational preferences, and secular styles of music. The lecture portion of this recital will also prove interesting to many modern church musicians, since the most common issues plaguing many church music programs have not changed, as so in the past couple of years. Since the time of these great musicians, congregations have always had their input into church music by saying that the church music is too loud, too quiet, too short, or too long. It's something that still happens every day in churches. It is also noted in the various sources for Bach and Händel that the church musicians have always felt underpaid for the amount of work that they do, and were therefore at odds with those running the church, something I can see from our audiences. But tonight we are going to start with the music of Antonio Vivaldi, and discussing a little bit of the shift that was taking place surrounding the music of his time. Due to various revolutions and the growing working class during the lead up to the time of Vivaldi, the aristocracy became less and less important to the masses. This led to the aristocracy attempting to remember their rural pastoral life, which helped lead to various pastoral themes in music and even in church music. Around this time, there was more accessibility to education and more books available to the masses, which led to people being more interested in performing and listening to different styles of music at the time. Eventually, this increase in music's accessibility created a demand for new music for every occasion, leading to the large outputs of many of our 18th century composers that we know today. This led to new innovations and new styles being created, which were enjoyed by those outside of the aristocracy. The aristocracy, on the other hand, preferred some of the older, simpler music, which led to just another difference between the societal classes of the time. I often wondered when I was doing my research if part of this societal difference and the music difference was the aristocracy wanting the older times so they had more power as well. During this time, conservatories for orphan children were increasing. Many of these conservatories specialized in music instruction and performance. There were at least four conservatories in Venice, which led to the city being the pinnacle of European music. However, at the beginning of the 18th century, this city was declining in political and economic Court, which led to the musical productions to suffer. Being known throughout Europe for its musical quality, the city of Venice took great pride in church music, chamber music, and operas that its composers created. Among the most well-known of these composers from Venice was Antonio Vivaldi. He was born in 1678 in Venice, Italy, during the time when the Venetian influence over music and economics was waning. During his lifetime, Vivaldi lived primarily in Venice and produced over 500 concerti, numerous operas, various church music, and it helped develop the slow movements of concertos, which were then later built upon by composers, including Johann Sebastian Bach. Due to the manufacturing boom that had taken place, Vivaldi lived during a time when Venetian composers were expected to create new music for every state and church holiday, along with the various feast day celebrations. Before Vivaldi's time, many composers wrote mainly for the church. However, Vivaldi's world saw a shift where composers began to write more for opera houses and orphanages, leading to more secular compositions. Vivaldi was a violinist and had studied with Giovanni Legrenzi, the Maestro di Cappella at San Marco in Venice, Italy. Legrenzi was also a composer in addition to being a violin teacher, and one of the themes from his compositions was later used by Bach as the theme for an organ theme. Even though Vivaldi was a virtuoso on the violin, he was the eldest son of five from a poor family, which meant he was destined to become a priest, which he did by the age of 25. And even though by age 15, Vivaldi received the tonsure or the monastic haircut, and he was on his way to becoming a priest, he never actually went to seminary due to a weakness that he had that followed him for the rest of his life. The same year that Vivaldi was ordained, 1703, was the first time that his name appears as a teacher at the Ospedale della Pietà, one of four orphanage conservatories in Venice that cared for orphan girls. Due to his red hair, Vivaldi was nicknamed Il Prete Rosso, or the Red-Headed Priest. And even though he had that nickname, Vivaldi did not live out his duties as a priest very long due to a tightness in his chest that forced him to leave saying Mass in the middle of service. This was noted in a letter written by Vivaldi in 1737. However, it was noted by other scholars that although Vivaldi was unable to say an entire Mass on multiple occasions, he never seemed to have a problem when he was conducting programs at the Ospedale. This seems to be a convenient way for Vivaldi to use the church financial backing while being able to pursue other musical avenues. After alleged affairs with Anna Girard, a singer who became a lead in many of his operas, Vivaldi was essentially removed from the priesthood. Toward the end of his life, Vivaldi was penniless and had the funeral of a pauper. Vivaldi was buried in an unmarked grave in Venice. The liturgical output of Vivaldi is composed of three main categories: Mass parts, song settings, and sacred motets. Most of Vivaldi's Mass part settings focused on the music and prayers represented in the Office of Vespers and were comprised of many movements. When I was in my undergrad studying opera, I often wondered why pieces like the Vivaldi Gloria had 12 movements that were all sung during Mass, even though it was only one prayer, and my music history professor reminded us that there weren't as many other forms of entertainment back then. They didn't have YouTube, easily accessible books, social media, or websites like Wikipedia were one thing they lost for hours. Multiple Mass part settings were also a custom in Italy that eventually spread out to other countries when composers adapted those practices as well. This ability to adapt and use Vivaldi's liturgical music beyond the borders of Venice is partially due to the result of the Council of Trent standardizing the order of the liturgy. However, in Venice, there were some who did not like being under the control of the Pope, and it has been noted that the church Vivaldi served used a slightly different form of the Mass than other Catholic churches of this time. 18th century sacred music began to be invaded by styles that were common and popular in other spaces, such as the theater. This seems to have a natural progression to the music of our later composers, Handel and Bach. This was partially due to the musical styles being able to portray the sacred texts so well. Many people who study Vivaldi's music note that much of his liturgical output is very inspired by operas, theater music, and concertos. Particularly noted for its elements of secular music in a sacred setting is Vivaldi's Stabat Mater, which was prescribed for the Mass of the Feast of the Seven Sorrows of the Blessed Virgin Mary following the Council of Trent. The music chosen tonight to represent Vivaldi comes from a psalm setting and a setting of the Gloria prayer spoken during the Mass. The first piece, Nisi Dominus, is a nine-part setting of the 126th or 127th psalm, depending on the numbering system being used, and it was written between 1713 and 1717. In addition to the psalm itself, Vivaldi wrote movements for the Gloria Patri, Sicut erat in principio, and the final Amen movement. Tonight, I will start with the opening movement from this work, and the final movement will be heard at the very end of the presentation. The second piece comes from the Mass setting of the Gloria Prayer, and it is the 10th movement out of 12 movements, and uses the Latin words, "For you who sit at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us." And due to the positioning of the organ, I will actually be singing up from the organ loft tonight, so I will be running, but not running. I'll be walking. Until the 18th century, most of the leading European composers came from Italy. The 18th century, however, saw more composers from Germanic-speaking areas becoming the musical leaders of their time. This was due to their ability to synthesize various compositional elements from the surrounding countries, where the Italian and French composers mostly focused on the forms developed within their countries. German composers like Bach and Handel began to incorporate various French, Italian, and German elements in new ways. The political structure of Germanic lands of the time was quite helpful to the output of Germanic music, since there were hundreds of cities, towns, and other political areas that all hired musicians. The German aristocrats avidly pursued music and supported their musicians. However, each of the musicians also supported their own salaries through public concerts and by publishing their music. The idea of just being a composer is a relatively new invention in the world of music. Unheard of One of the most prominent composers from German-speaking lands who embodied this was Georg Friedrich Handel. Handel was born in Halle, Germany on February 23, 1685. And although Handel's father wanted him to study law, he played for the Duke, and Handel was able to convince his father to let him study music. Handel studied organ under Friedrich Sachau, who was the greatest organist in the Lutheran Church at Halle, but after 3 years, Sachau stated he had nothing left to teach Handel. While Vivaldi reached notoriety for the music he wrote for the church in the Ospedale della Pietà, Handel reached his greatest fame writing music for public performance, namely his operas and his oratorios. Due to his popularity, he is considered to be the first composer to have his music be continually performed since the time it was originally written. Even here in the United States, the Bethany Oratorio Society in Bethany, Kansas, has sung his work Messiah every year since 1882, making it the longest-running annual Messiah performance in the United States. Handel is also widely considered to be the first composer to compose music for the public and not just a church, a royal court, or a town council. Throughout his career, Handel enjoyed the support of many patrons. However, even with these patrons supporting his music creation, he found the need to supplement his salary with other means. Of the three composers presented tonight, Handel is the most traveled, having worked in a number of German-speaking cities, as well as the Italian cities of Florence, Venice, Naples, and Rome. Handel and Vivaldi overlapped for a short time in Venice, but through my research, it is unclear if Handel and Vivaldi had any interaction with one another during the time they were both in the city. Vivaldi was largely known for his instrumental music and the musical developments and ideas that stem from his work, while Handel was known for his vocal music. Handel is known for his operas and their incorporation of the various national styles of music, from the French motifs in the dances, the Italian elements in the arias, all accompanied with Germanic elements of orchestration, including having the instruments double the vocal line. Although Handel's operas saw quite a bit of success, he is mostly known for his English oratorios, a style which many say he invented, although there's more information on that later. Oratorios are a style of music where a biblical story is told dramatically, set to the same style of music as an opera, but with large choruses and orchestral writing. Handel's oratorios were slightly different from his operas in the way that they were written, because they included more choral movements. The choirs would act as many different parts throughout the oratorios, including the narrators of the story, a Greek chorus commenting on the action, and at times, the choir would portray certain characters. These oratorios appealed more to the middle class because they knew the stories, and they did not feel as much at home with the Italian operas that the aristocracy enjoyed. This, in addition to the fact that operas could not be produced during Lent due to church regulations, led Handel to write a new oratorio almost annually for 7 years in order to supplement his income. Even though these were permitted to be produced during Lent, they were not considered religious music, since they were intended for the concert hall and were not intended to be performed during any religious services. Handel also recognized that social changes and public taste would have an effect on the music that needed to be produced, and he made sure to keep up with the times, producing music or reusing some of his earlier music that was popular. Surely this understanding and large breadth of work produced for the public audience is one of the reasons that some of Handel's music has also become part of our church music history, including the famous Hallelujah chorus from Handel's Messiah. Handel became blind in 1753 and was operated on by a surgeon named John Taylor. However, this did not yield any results. But remember the name John Taylor, because that is going to come up again shortly. Even though he was blind, Handel still continued to play the organ and to conduct performances of his musical works. It was during a musical performance of Messiah in 1759 that Handel collapsed, and when he was taken home, he is reported to have said that he would like to die on Good Friday. Handel died early in the morning on Easter Sunday on April 14, 1759. Unlike many other composers of his time and many composers since, Handel had a highly attended funeral, with a reported 3,000 people attending at Westminster Abbey where he was buried. Even after his death, Handel's music had a pull on the public in a positive light, leading to King George III to sponsor a festival of all Handel's music in an attempt to rebuild his own reputation after the unpleasantness that was taking place in the American colonies. Handel wrote a total of 46 operas, 32 oratorios, and more than 100 large-scale vocal works, in addition to a number of instrumental works. Tonight we will hear music from two of the oratorios that Handel wrote, Messiah and Solemn. Like I said earlier, oratorios are musical settings of dramatic religious texts that were intended to be performed with soloists, choruses, instrumentalists, but without any action or scenery. Oratorios were not written for church services, however, there is still evidence that they were occasionally performed in church as they came out of the liturgical dramas that were acted out during worship. They sort of became, started to take those, the place of those. Although some consider Handel to be the inventor of the oratorio, there is much evidence that the idea for them was originally born out of the practices of Philip Neri, a priest who began leading an oratory or a house of prayer, including Bible study, sermons, and spiritual laws and songs, being composed and performed by some of the time's most famous musicians, like Palestrina. Over time, these oratories began to be led by more and more professional musicians, and it became so popular that in 1575, Pope Gregory VIII created the Congregazione dell'Oratorio, which then spread throughout the rest of Europe. The first piece that we will hear by Handel tonight is from the Oratorio Saul, which is the dramatic setting of the story of the first monarch of the United Kingdom of Israel, who was composed in 1738. The libretto, or text, was written by Charles Jennens and was taken largely from the first book of Samuel. Saul focuses on the relationship between Saul and David, his successor, and tells the story of Saul's downfall. The oratorio begins just after David has slain Goliath and tells the story through the death of Saul. The piece presented tonight is from the first act and is sung by David in an attempt to soothe King Saul after he becomes jealous of a chorus of praise directed toward David. The oratorio Saul is filled with so much good music, but I feel like it gets overshadowed by Handel's Messiah, so I hope that this will encourage you all to take a listen to some of the other music from Saul at some point. There's actually been a trend recently to fully stage this oratorio, even though that was not its original practice, and if you go on YouTube and type in Handel's Saul, you will see some of those productions, and they're really, really great. The second piece comes from the oratorio Messiah, which is the story of Jesus' birth, that life and resurrection. Undoubtedly the most famous piece from Messiah is the Hallelujah Chorus, which comes just at the end of part two. However, it should not be considered the climactic point of the entire piece, even though it is often thought so today. The text for this oratorio is taken from the King James Bible and the Coverdale Bible, with other texts written by Charles Jennens. And Messiah is often misnamed the Messiah. However, it is just called Messiah. Composed in just under a month, in 1741, the original performance was held in Dublin on April 13, 1742. I'll be singing a movement from the first part of Messiah with the text taken from the book of Isaiah. Thank you. Who was born in Eisenach, Thuringia, which is located in present-day Germany, on March 26, 1685. Even though Bach came from a musical family, he was a mostly self-taught musician. Bach's parents died when he was just 9 years old, and he went to live with his brother, Johann Christoph, until he was 15. While living with his brother in Lüneburg, he joined the choir and was given the opportunity to continue his study by studying various musical scores, composition, the organ, clavichord, and the violin. Bach's youth was filled with a thirst to know more about music, and led him to walk great distances to hear other musicians, specifically organists. There are a few letters that were written by some of Bach's contemporaries that said that he knows nothing beyond theology and music. One incredible example for Bach's thirst for knowledge is the story of how at age 19, he walked 213 miles from Arnstadt to Lübeck to hear the organist Dietrich Buxtehude play. He did that journey two times, 213 miles there and 213 miles back, on foot. While living in Arnstadt, the organ at the Arnstadt Bachkirche, which was later named the Bachkirche, had its dedicatory performance played by Bach in 1703, and one of the coolest things, especially if you're an organist or a Bach lover, is you can go to the Bachkirche in Arnstadt and still hear the pipes and some of the stops that Bach played on, because they were kept throughout all the renovations. They were preserved throughout the renovations, which is really fascinating. Throughout his musical career, Bach held many positions throughout German-speaking areas in modern-day Germany. Among these, Bach served as an organist in Neuhausen, where he married his cousin, Maria Barbara, and he also served as the court organist of Duke Wilhelm Ernst of Weimar for 9 years, where he gained a reputation as an organ virtuoso. While he was in Weimar, Bach wrote many of his most famous organ works, including the amazing Pasichalian Fugue in C minor, and began work on the Orgelbüchlein, which is a book of organ chorale preludes that follows the liturgical calendar. During his time in Weimar, Bach also became fascinated with the instrumental music of our first composer, Vivaldi. From Vivaldi, Bach claims to have learned to write clearer harmonic structures, more concise themes, and more structured forms that Vivaldi had perfected. Bach was invited to become the music director for Prince Leopold of Anhalt in Köthen in 1717, although he had some difficulty leaving his current position in Weimar. Bach was happy with his new advancement, but his boss, Duke Wilhelm, was not. And after asking to be released to work for Prince Leopold, the Duke placed Bach under house arrest for a month, just for requesting the dismissal. However, Bach did eventually make it to Köthen. And while in Köthen, he wrote much of his instrumental work, since he was the leader of a 17-piece band that he directed. And it just goes to show how much of these composers' music was inspired by the groups around them, specifically with Bach, because he wrote a lot of organ music when he was just the organist, and instrumental music when he had his orchestra, and also his choir when he gets to Leipzig. And it's the same thing for both Vivaldi and Händel. It was during this time in Köthen when he wrote his Brandenburg Concertos and the first book of the Well-Tempered Clavier. Bach described his time in Köthen as the happiest period of his professional life. His first wife, Maria Barbara, died in 1720, and he went on to marry Anna Magdalena Wilken 18 months later. You might recognize this name as the namesake for Bach's compilation of a notebook for Anna Magdalena Bach. At 36 years old, Bach was 16 years her senior when they married. Anna Magdalena bore him 13 children, in addition to the 7 he previously had with his wife, his other wife. However, only 10 of Bach's children survived their childhood. 6 months after Bach and Anna Magdalena were married, one of the most prestigious musical positions in Europe opened up, the cantor position at the Thomasschule in Leipzig. Although he was known as an organ virtuoso and a fine musician and composer, Bach was not the first choice for the position. Although he was well known in his time, but he was not famous to the likes of Handel. The position was first offered to Telemann, another famous contemporary of Bach's, and their second choice was Christoph Krautner, and it just shows you, I had never come across the name Christoph Krautner until I did this research. Bach was at the was the Thomas Schule's third choice and became their cantor in April 1723 and remained there for the rest of his life. Among his many duties at the Thomas Schule, Bach was expected to play the organ both for the Thomas Kirche and occasionally the Nikolai Kirche. He was also in charge of teaching Latin to the boys enrolled at the school and directed and training the various church musicians that were also employed by the Thomas Kirche. Another duty that fell to Bach was the expectation to gather his own firewood, at least at the beginning of his tenure. While at the Thomasschule, Bach had a continual battle with those in charge due to the low amount he was being paid, which is, you know, as I said earlier, something I found very interesting, since many church musicians are still very underpaid for the work that they do. While in Leipzig, Bach wrote many large works, such as his two passions, the St. John and the St. Matthew Passion, the Mass in B minor, numerous cantatas, the beautiful Goldberg variation, and a lot more organ work. Bach's vision began to deteriorate due to cataracts, and he was operated on by John Taylor, the same optician that unsuccessfully operated on Kendall for his vision problems. Bach was still left blind, so John Taylor, don't go with him. And even though he was almost completely blind, his sight miraculously returned, so that, and he continued to work on his final composition, The Art of the Few, which was based on the spelling of his name, B-A-C-H. And you might be asking where the letter H comes from in the musical alphabet, because normally, you know, it's A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. But in German, the letter H is a B natural, while the letter B is a B flat that goes all the way back to a long time ago, when B natural was considered a hard B or a pontus A, which is where we get the H from. Bach died 10 days after his sight return at the age of 65, where he was buried in an unmarked grave in Leipzig. Eventually, what is thought to be the remains of Bach were transferred to the choir area of the Thomaskirche, where numerous musical pilgrims traveled to pay their respects to this great musician. Bach's time in Leipzig was a time of prolific creation. In his previous positions, Bach was at the whim of various royal leaders, but in this new position at the Leipzig Thomaskirche, Bach was introduced to a more collegial leadership. Bach welcomed this because he saw his ultimate artistic goal come to fruition, which was well-regulated, theologically sound church music. We're still thriving. As the cantor in the Thomaskirche, Bach was also responsible for the music in the Nikolai Kirche as well. Often on high feast days, when a new cantata would be performed, there would be a performance in the morning at one of the churches in the morning service, and in the afternoon they would travel to the other church and perform the same cantata later that day. And when I first read this, I was expecting these churches, you know, that you get back in your horse and buggy and, you know, travel with all your instruments. But then I remembered my time in Leipzig and realized that they're within walking distance of one another. And not even walking, like a 5-minute walk from one another. And that led me to think of the congregational dynamics of those two churches that were within the same denomination and how different our church dynamics are, even within our same denomination. It just made me think, you know, the more things change, the more things stay the same. A lot of the early music that was written by these composers was done in an attempt to, just like our praise bands, drive up attendance. One of Bach's large-scale works, the St. John Passion, was composed in an attempt to drive up church attendance at the Thomaskirche in Leipzig. I don't think it worked. Among the other works Bach wrote in Leipzig were his vast number of cantatas. These cantatas came out of a Lutheran tradition to enhance the gospel reading for the day. Originally, these pieces were motets that highlighted central verses from the Bible and were eventually replaced by concertato movements with arias and choral movements, and eventually they were replaced by the cantata. It is from this that the German Lutheran theologian and poet Edmund Neumeister began writing texts that functioned as musical sermons. From this, a clear pattern of traditional Lutheran bifocal homiletic structure of explicato and applicato can be seen, specifically within Bach's Leipzig motets. Bach considered his occupation as a church musician to relate to the proclamation of the word tied to his office and as a sort of relationship with David. Each of Bach's works were signed Soli Deo Gloria at the end, which means to God be the glory, to signify that the work was to praise God. Bach stands for so much more than just the music itself. Paul Westermeyer notes that Bach's music is what happens when music grows out of, yet beyond worship. Even after, or even further, Bach is considered the musical result of Luther. In fact, the emphasis that Martin Luther placed on music was second only to Luther's concern to preaching the Word of God. Luther's work united many groups of people through his chorales, which appealed across many boundaries. And Luther's chorales alternated between the congregation singing in unison and the choir or instruments playing or singing in a polyphonic or multi-part setting. Since the days of Luther, the tradition of Lutheran hymnody has inspired numerous hymn tune writers, various composers, and editors to create new congregational settings. And I was very surprised, having been a church organist, pianist, and chorister for over a decade, when I was recently playing at a Missouri Synod Lutheran church, and I was during this past Lent, there were so many Lutheran hymns that I did not know. And they're really fantastic. Tonight, I am pleased to bring you two movements from Bach's work. The first is the SOEM piece from the Magnificat in D major, composed in 1723. This movement comes from the first large scale liturgical work in Latin by Bach, written shortly after his arrival in Leipzig. Compared to many other Lutheran practices, the city of Leipzig used a large amount of Latin in their church services, and Bach noted this in an earlier visit in 1714. The second selection is the opening movement from Vergnügte Ruhe beliebte Seelenlust, a solo cantata composed for the sixth Sunday after Trinity Sunday, first performed in 1726. And the text for that day is mostly taken from the Sermon of the Mount from the Gospel of Matthew. And the cantata consists of five parts. The opening portion reminds us of the inner peace that comes from Christ, followed by a recitative, or a sort of sung-spoken sermon that speaks of the world being a house of sin. The third movement is a symbolic representation of our lives if we ignore the Word of God. And the fourth movement is another recitative reminding us to live with God whose name is love. And it concludes with an aria that is revolted by the world. question came up in one of my meetings with Dr. Barnett, I think it was our final meeting, about what we can reclaim from this music. And that was the question that I struggled with, because for me, it's simple. I can still sing this music, and it's fantastic music. But as I stated earlier, from Rick Harrison, the music that we sing in church gives an insight to the changes of the church. It gives insight to the changes of the voice that goes beyond just the words that we say. Some of the best music came from when these composers were given the freedom to do what they do best, to compose and to lead music. Both Bach and Handel took the English choral tradition and adapted it into new styles to serve multiple functions in their respective works, both oratorios and passions. In both of Bach's passions and Handel's oratorios, the choirs served a different role. They began to be as characters within the story. And they would oftentimes have choruses where they would reflect the theological beliefs of the day. Although the large-scale oratorios, passions, masses, and requiems written by these Baroque composers were inspired by the church and theology of the day, we have to remember they were not considered church music, nor were many of them intended for worship as the various masses written by Renaissance and medieval composers were. While this was happening, many saw the development of the church as the church pulling away from creativity and abandoning music and the arts to those around it. It's sad to think that this is still happening within our churches. Our churches cling, and I'm a staunch traditionalist with music, obviously, but our churches cling to the old music, shying away from new compositions in an attempt to stake a claim on tradition and outdated theology. However, the music that we've heard tonight by Vivaldi, Handel, and Bach was created for that day's modern theology, or contemporary theology. They had the freedom to create new music, new styles, and new combinations of works to give the voice of the church, to give the voice a new church, to give the church a new voice. Oh, it's been a long night. Even looking at how the oratorios and cantatas were shaped through history shows that these new styles can and are still life-giving, spiritually filled creations that give the church a new voice for new times. Even in today's churches, there's so much back and forth surrounding the debate of contemporary Christian music versus traditional music in worship, and I used to be part of that debate. I used to be a staunch traditionalist, still am, with regard to music. However, after doing this project, I started to see the need for new avenues of music within our church service, and it's opened my understanding of church music. Dr. Barnett also asked, what defines sacred music? And what has defined sacred music throughout history? And my first response is, well, obviously it's the music that we sing in our services. However, going back through history and seeing the binary of traditional versus contemporary, I think we can't say that. Sacred music is anything that brings us closer to the divine. Even looking at Handel's Messiah shows us that music that wasn't written to be performed in a church can teach us a great deal about who we are and where we have come from through music. I would like to thank you all for coming tonight, and a huge, huge thank you to Dr. Barnett for letting me explore this merger between my passion and church history. I'm not a huge history person, but this is super exciting. Dr. Barnett and I geeked out so many times, which was fantastic. Huge, huge thank you to Casey Cantwell. Final thank you to the Parish Church of St. Jerome for hosting this evening and for opening your doors to all of us. I would like to finish tonight with the final movement, the Amen, from Vivaldi's Nisi Domus.
And a reception.
And there's a reception downstairs.
Downstairs. Afterwards, where you can have a conversation.
That's why she didn't teach.
Jinxing.